Jossie, you know, we talk off and on, and you know, I absolutely love you, and I don't make a distinction. You know, so as I was talking, I was like, your community, my community, we're all part of the same community as far as I'm concerned, and whether we're the face invisible or visible, the impact is the same. Do you know, talk about how it's directly impacting you.
Well, with me, I mean, the most obvious way for me is, and this is something that's common. So when you're talking about Native communities, specifically in the Southwest, because that's where it's been most pronounced, the Navajo Nation, the Zuni Pueblo, Hopi Nation, they've all been just absolutely you know, it's devastating down there. The percentages, they say on the Navajo Nation, they have within that small population group, that discrete and insular population group, they're talking about more than the rest of the state of New Mexico. It's crazy. And part of the reason why is because amongst Native people, it's a stereotype, but it's stereotypes are oftentimes based upon truth. We respect our elders. And as an example of that, my mom lives, she's here with me right now. She's in the house. My 71, almost 72-year-old mom. And it's very common to find multi-generational living within the same household. And, you know, I haven't hugged my mom in 2 months because I'm an attorney, I'm a lawyer. So I have to go to the courthouses, I have to go to jails and see people who may or may not be infecting me. I take precautions, you know, I have gloves on, I wear the mask, I do all that stuff. But, you know, none of that stuff is foolproof. And so when you have that sort of living situation where the family really is tight, and we're seeing more than just a nuclear family, where there's actually multi-generations and there's nieces and nephews and there's uncles and aunties under the same house or within the same complex, and because of many, many reasons, we're interdependent on each other. We rely upon each other in a way that's antiquated to much of America, but works very, very well for us, and I believe it's actually healthier. When you see that, you have the prospect of people being infected at incredibly disparate rates. So for me, the most, you know, up here in Washington State, the reservation, the numbers haven't been too pronounced. I have seen death. I've lost, you know, several friends that were elders to this virus. I have an uncle who's in ICU right now. But you know, part of it is the prospect and the notion that you have to be separate from your family, and when family is a real thing to you, it's not the family that, you know, makes fun of their dad or their mom on Family Guy, what white America does. We don't do that. It's actually something that's significant to us, and it's really, really distressing and traumatic to be away from them.
I'm curious because I feel like there was so much misinformation that made its way into Black communities, just in specifically into Black communities. Have you felt like there was misinformation in the Native American community as well, or just lack of information too? Or what are your thoughts on how information got in?
Well, you know, first off, I'm Native and Black, so I get misinformation from both sides.
Just totally misinformed.
Every place, yeah. But you know, specifically in regards to Native people, I mean, first of all, we have Native people just like there's Black folks, just like there's a whole bunch of white folks who don't believe science. That's first and foremost. You know, we have this weird thing that unless there's a level of relativity, unless we can see it, we lost a loved one due to it. We think it's fake. And there's Native people like that. I have a cousin who's on tribal council, one of the elected leaders for the Macaw tribe, and he gets those calls every day. He plays me the voicemails, and sometimes they're really entertaining because they got the newest Alex Jones theory, and you know they're talking. It's crazy. Speaking of the Macaw tribe, just real quick, Drew and Karen, there's this one of the unique, because I think that's kind of where we're going, is the unique challenges that we have. And the unique perspectives that we have. I don't know if you know this right now, but there is a standoff going on in South Dakota where the Native community, the Cheyenne River Sioux tribe, as well as the Pine Ridge Sioux tribe, they said, we are going to exercise our autonomous sovereign rights to close this border to protect our people because we don't have access to a lot of facilities where if you guys come in and we're repeating history, white people getting us sick again, we don't have the capacity to, you know, put them in ICU, all these people in ICU units. And so now the governor of South Dakota has said that's illegal. We're going to take you to court. And ostensibly what they're saying, this wasn't her exact words, but we're going to seek criminal or civil prosecution or remedy against you for protecting your people. That's crazy. You can't protect your people. So the reason why I wanted to relay that to the Macaw tribe is because I sent out this Instagram thing that this guy posted, because Macaw tribe, a small tribe in the northwestern coast of Washington state, they did the same thing. They closed down their borders. We're not going to let you infect us. We've played that before. We've seen that movie before. We don't want to do that again. And this guy's, you know, doing threats saying, you know, I hate F Native Americans, F Native people. You can't. And so all of this stuff, similar to, you know, the Black community, similar to the Latinx community, whenever there's crisis, it becomes fans. And we see this with all these militia people, G.I. Joe action figures going to the Michigan Capitol, going to the Washington Capitol. It always becomes a fan for the flames of racism. That's what's coming out of this, is that there's really, really pronounced racism, definitely toward Native people, but it's coming out toward Black folks as well, because we, you know, we've seen the just the proliferation of violence toward Black people by law enforcement, state-sanctioned violence. Obviously, the Ahmaud Arbery, the lynching. And I know people have flinched at that terminology, but that's what it was. So we're seeing similar to that, and, you know, please rest in peace to that man, and, you know, comfort to his family, and I hope he finds the closest thing to justice, because he's not going to get justice because he's not here. There's nothing that's going to bring him back. But we're seeing that ramping up of racism in times of crisis that always, always happens, and Native people certainly haven't been immune to that. Twyla, I want to hear your thoughts. I mean, I don't want to monopolize the microphone, but I wanted to make that clear that this violence is not random. It's not arbitrary. It's coming from a very specific place, and it's happening to both Black and Native communities.
We've been talking about on these airwaves, and you're listening to the Karen Hunter Show, about the cavalry not coming. There's not going to be anybody to rescue us. So we're going to have to wrangle in some of these comorbidities, some of these pre-existing conditions that we have. I know in our community, you know, diabetes, high blood pressure. In the Native community, you guys have the highest prevalence of risk factors of obesity, substance abuse, sudden infant death syndrome, diabetes, liver disease, everything, and hepatitis. You know, there's like, yeah, and but that's an us, like, yes, that's systemic, it's racism, it's this, but there's got to be, just, Jossie, as you started off talking about the community, I remember my dad was telling me that I was going to get high blood pressure because he has it and my mom has it. And I'm like, no, I'm not, because I'm not eating like you. And I made them eat differently. I made them eat differently when I would come over. I'm like, I'm not eating that stuff. You're going to make me some salmon, some broccoli, and some rice. That was our dinner every Sunday. There's got to be some veggies. There's going to be some fish, a little piece of fish, and some rice. And it changed a lot of the culture in that household, because there was a line drawn in the sand. I think, what is that going to do? Like, how do we get that message out, too? Because those underlying conditions in this pandemic is literally killing us.
No, definitely. And, you know, there's obviously always going to be personal autonomy, agency, the ability to change our own fates. But I'm going to push back on you in a second, Karen, regarding what we could do different prospectively, because I think we understand that COVID-19 is the dress rehearsal before something really, really bad. This one right here is a glorified cold. That's the reason why there was coronavirus warnings on Lysol and stuff like that, because we've seen it before. There's a part of it that's novel, of course, but it's a glorified cold. This isn't the thing that has the morbidity of the movie Contagion or something like that. And how do we, you know, prepare for something like that? That's tricky, because we've been spoiled with so much interconnectedness that, you know, and you see that with these crazy people going out and doing everything as normal. What I think there has to be, Drew, is a clear hierarchy. of people that have the ability to say, nah, you're not going to do this. If you are doing this, you're flouting our community values. I'm not sure that within most communities, there's that ability for somebody to say, no, this is how we're going to behave in this particular instance. And, you know, I think about it from the context of, you know, Black people. Black people are so urbanized to the degree that urban has become synonymous with Black, right? When people talk about urban youth, they're talking about Black youth. When people talk about urban, they're talking about Black people. That's a misnomer historically, because Black people have only, as of the Great Migration, you know, less than 100 years, been inside of cities for the most part. So I think there has to be this thing within Native communities, but also the Black communities, of learning how to actually tend to some land, whether it's a community piece of property or within our backyard, to go get some cucumbers, to go get some tomatoes, to go get something where we don't have to be going to Safeway or Kroger's or whatever, and getting all these people that don't respect social distancing, that don't respect diseases, and staying away from them for a little bit.
Don't respect us.
Literally. Huh?
And don't respect us.
Yeah, that's right. Don't care about us one bit. Right. Like, we're Ishii. I'm not sure if you know who Ishii is, Karen. It was this dude, he was considered the last person of his tribe in California. He really wasn't. But he was actually literally brought around as a museum exhibit to, you know, people can poke at him and see this Indian dude. And that's the way we're seen for a lot of the time, where people, white people specifically, feel that they have a right, an entitlement, whether it's to go to our land, even though our elected leaders say, no, you're not going to come here and infect us, or whether to, you know, chase down and hunt like an animal. Like Brother Arbery, like, that's just horrible stuff. They think they have a right to our flesh, to our bodies, and we got to be able to be in a position where we can say, nah, we're not going to do that. We're going to, you know, do our farm or even our little garden. Okay, Karen, real quick, I know running out of time, but I understand completely about personal agency and autonomy, and we have to take accountability for the stuff we can control. Absolutely. You know, I have my mom. She's here exercising every day. She gets mad at me, but I'm reminded. I'm on her every single day. Like, mom, now you got to do this. You got to do this. Okay, you want to watch TV? Cool. But we gotta, you know, take our steps in place. We have a responsibility to that. However, those things can't be divorced from those structural inequities. And I know you know this. I'm not saying you don't. But, you know, the food deserts that exist within the inner city, but also exist within our Native communities, where the main source of nutrition is the grocery store that's also a gas station. That's not a good place.
Right.
That creates those underlying conditions.
Right.
When we don't have access to health care, as Dr. Baker was talking about, in an equitable fashion. And so all we can do is go to a clinic, to an IHS clinic, and no disrespect to IHS workers. IHS means Indian Health Services. No disrespect to those folks. Those folks are working as hard as they can, but they simply are not funded at the levels that are required in order to provide the best levels of health care to us. That creates underlying conditions. When there's a constant threat on our lives, as we've seen with the you know, murders of these Black men in the past week, but that happens within our communities, where these people want to go into our communities and infect us and do horrible things to us, and there are, our lands are a jurisdictional vacuum where people can literally get away with murder. That's stressful. I've never drank alcohol in my life, Karen, but I can't blame somebody who wants to drink away that pain, who says that, man, you know what, this is I need to ease that tension. And so we see those numbers in a vacuum, and, oh, okay, well, there's a high proliferation of alcoholism or whatever. But those conditions are very real, and I think that those, trying to address those at the same time, while taking personal agency and autonomy, are important to have a multi-tiered approach to those sort of problems.